So in the first session, we talked about the context of why we want to solve the Bateman equation, and now we're going to talk about the actual terms that go into the Bateman equation. So we talked about the radioactive decay fissions and neutron absorptions. For each of those, we're going to have a loss component. So you have loss from nuclide I, and we have production 2I for each of these. And that basically ends up giving you your Bateman equation once you've added and subtracted all these. So the losses, I'm not actually going to put a negative sign in front, but we'll put that once we get it into the equation. But you have the decay constant times the number density. This is the simplest term. You notice that it does not include the neutron flux. And then the production is going to be similar, where we have things decaying, but now we have other nuclides decaying to this, so let's call it lambda j nj, and we're going to sum over all the other isotopes j, but this obviously doesn't work because, you know, this would count every single decay into our, every single decay would be going into the isotope. Obviously that's not going to happen. So we need a branching ratio, which I'm going to call gamma D for decay, and that would be, let's see, we want from J to I. So I'll put the arrow backwards, and that's pretty tight there, but basically I'm doing, let me write that again, gamma D J, I comes first, but J is the source, and I is the endpoint, the result. So that's going to be, you know, usually 0 and 1, usually 0, occasionally 1. Occasionally you'll have a, you know, half or a quarter or whatever the value is for certain reactions. So there's, you know, certain nuclides that will, they'll decay by beta mostly, but possibly by electron capture, or maybe they decay to the same nuclide, but one of them is in a metastable state, excited state, and one is in a ground state. So this gamma would capture all of those different pathways. You could have, you know, more than two, you could have three, possibly. Usually it's just one, but there's always the exceptions. Fissions, so we have sigma F I times the flux times the number density. And similarly, we're going to have the production 2I, so now we're going to be doing the flux, the fissions from nuclide J, and again we have to sum over those, and again we have to have branching ratios, and these are actually called sigma F I J. There's actually a name for these are called fission yields, and there's you know, tables of fission yields in the evaluated nuclear data files, so you can look those up. And then sigma neutron absorptions, here I am going to say that we're going to use the capture cross section here, because that basically the, I'll just write it quickly, the absorption cross section equals the fission plus the capture. So we'll use both of those here. So the capture cross section times the flux times number density, and then the production term is going to look identically sigma C I J sigma C J flux times number density of J. So basically we're going to rewrite these six terms in one equation now. Well, we'll keep them as the production and the losses. So the production of I, of nuclide I, we'll have all the summation terms here now. Sum J, the fission IJ, fission cross-section, flux NJ. That was the fission. Have the capture next. Sigma capture J, flux, number density, plus the sigma d I j lambda j n j. So that's the production side, and then the loss side. The loss term is easier to write with less, well, with no summations, as I'll say, the losses is just the diagonal, just appears on the diagonal, and you have, we can combine the fission and capture into the absorption for I times the flux times Ni plus the decay. Okay, so we've defined the production and the loss. So we can write dNi dt equals pi. Well, and here I've I guess I should write this as pi n li n, and then we can write p. This is going to be a vector times a vector. Plus or minus a vector times a vector. So these would be dot products, and this would give you one row in the matrix equation. So the matrix equation would just be dn dt equals, let's say, a n, where we let a equal p minus l. Yes. So we've given the details now about how we define the Bateman equation, and how does the A matrix look? Let's talk about that for a second. So you have your A matrix. It's mostly sparse, and let's just say we're looking at one element here in the ith row, so it's going to be on the diagonal, the little box here, and let's think about what the rows and the columns mean here. So the rows are going to be the source for this isotope. So I think about it as having arrows coming in. So the entries here, if you have large entries along the rows, you're going to have a large source into this box. And then the destruction terms are basically going to be distributing the isotopes from this nuclide into other nuclides. That's how I like to think about it. And this brings up a good thing to think about, is that we're not creating or destroying, you know, the total number of nuclides. And that should be conserved, more or less. Occasionally, you know, we lose some along the way, depending on which things, what nuclides we might neglect. But in general, we shouldn't be losing the total number of nuclides here. We should be conserving those. Obviously now, when you have fission, you know, you're going to have two or three fission products, so you know the total number is going to change because of that. But you're not just, you know, having something decay and disappear totally. So you can think about that as you, you know, solve these equations. And you can kind of use that sanity check as you're doing calculations of, well, did I lose you know, a bunch of nuclides somewhere, and if so, where are they going? Okay, we'll stop this session here.